Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. And good evening to all of you, and welcome to the final installment of the 2006-2007 Chancellor's Lecture Series. This evening, my privilege is to introduce to you Sean B. Carroll, Howard Hughes Institute Investigator and Professor of Molecular Biology and Genetics at the University of Wisconsin. Sean Carroll is a geneticist who has become the leader of the field of biology affectionately known as Evo-Devo. Now, Evo-Devo is not the name for the reunion of popular new wave band, but it is the name of what is considered the third wave in evolutionary biology, third in a wave effect that began with the publication of The Origin of the Species and surged through the integration of Darwin's theories with the study of genetics. Evo-Devo concentrates on the process by which a single cell develops into a complex organism. For decades, evolutionary biologists had to rely on fossil records and animal morphology in their study of evolution. But DNA evidence has furnished a much more sophisticated and much deeper evolutionary record. It enables scientists to look back 700 million years beyond the reach of fossils or physical clues to a common ancestor with a set of master genes, genetic instructions that are similar in all animals today, however differently those directives might be expressed. Genetics and the tools of molecular biology allow researchers in Evo-Devo to discover how new animal forms arise, how genes dictate the development and evolution of the form of an animal. The evidence shown by Sean Carroll's research points toward the end of rancorous debate over the validity of the theory of evolution. We, of course, in the state of Tennessee, have long been familiar with the rise by evolutionary debate. Evolution, according to Professor Carroll, is impossible to avoid. It is, quite bluntly, a natural law, as unassailable and unavoidable as gravity. Sean Carroll is the author of The Making of the Fittest, DNA and the Ultimate Forensic Record of Evolution, and co-author with Jen Garnier and Scott Weatherby of the textbook From DNA to Diversity, Molecular Genetics and the Evolution of Animal Design. He's the author of Endless Forms Most Beautiful, The New Science of Evo-Devo, and he is, in his research, the explorer of the pattern that unfolds those endless beautiful forms. Ladies and gentlemen, I present to you this evening our lecturer, Sean Carroll.
Good evening.
And there's your NOVA documentary on evolution for 2007. So thanks to Chancellor Gee for that kind introduction. And thank you all for taking the time to come out on a beautiful spring night in a beautiful campus, a beautiful auditorium to talk about science. Thanks to Vanderbilt for inviting me. I think I could tell that you enjoyed some of those excerpts. That's the brilliant Creature Comfort series from Nick Park, the creator of Wallace and Gromit. Those animals raise a lot of questions, somewhat bizarre questions at times, about evolution and about how new capabilities evolve and about genes and genomes. And my pleasure tonight is to update you on some of the great progress in understanding how evolution works and how the fittest are made and why it matters, why the understanding of evolution matters. And to do so, I'm going to show you some more strange and wonderful, and from here on out, I promise, real creatures. The first of which, and perhaps the most amazing animal I know of, requires that we follow the voyage of a ship a long, long time ago, a ship called the SS Norvegia in the Antarctic. And this is a picture of that ship taken by a zoology student who was on board, a student by the name of Detlef Rustad, and it was the practice in the Norwegian whaling fleet to send out zoology students with the whaling fleet to do some research, both to keep track a bit of the whale populations, but also to do some research on the marine biology of the Southern Ocean in this case. Now you can see these waters are a bit rough with all the ice floes around. Here's a picture, it was taken in 1928. Well, this research ship also had another very, very important mission, and that mission was to establish a shelter with provisions for shipwrecked sailors. Because one of the big hazards of whaling in the Southern Ocean in the first part of the 20th century were the storms and, of course, damage from these ice floes. And so this ship made its way, and Rustad snapped this shot of an island that was their best candidate to set up one of these shelters for shipwrecked sailors. And this is Bouvet Island, a hunk of rock sticking out of the Southern Ocean, snow-covered with black lava cliffs just dropping right to the ocean's edge, a really inhospitable place. But if you consider what the options were, I'll just show you from a map of this part of the world, there aren't many. This may well be the most isolated place on Earth. And if you're whaling anywhere in these waters or sailing for any other reason, Bouvet is your only option if you get in trouble. Just to give you a little orientation, of course, here's Antarctica, here's South Africa, here's the tip of South America, and here's South Georgia Island, and this is the island to which Shackleton rode to save the crew of the Endurance. So Rustad arrived at Bouvet Island in 1928, and he was interested in studying some of those marine creatures. And so what he was doing was casting every day with a net and seeing what he would bring up. And one day he brought up a really peculiar looking fish. And it looked like this. This huge protruding jaw on this fish that was very pale. And it turns out the whalers had seen this fish before and had dubbed it the ice fish because of its very pale body appearance and its association sort of being around these very icy waters. So Rustad was pretty intrigued with this very strange-looking fish, and he did what every good Norwegian should do, which is fillet it. And so, but when he filleted it, he found out it wasn't like any other fish that he had ever opened before, because its blood was completely colorless. So he was pretty puzzled by this, but he was just a young zoology student, and when he went back to Norway, he told some people about this. And this lore of the bloodless ice fish circulated around Norway for about 20 or 25 years till another zoologist, a fellow by the name of Johan Rud, decided to settle the mystery of this fish once and for all. And he traveled back to this, in this case, to South Georgia Island in the early 1950s and set up a makeshift laboratory, got some of these ice fish, brought them into the lab, opened them up, and took a look. Now, this is a modern photograph, but this is essentially what he found. When he opens up another sort of typical fish, something like a rock cod, he gets ordinary red blood in his tube. But this is what the blood of the ice fish looked like. No red color whatsoever. And what Rud was able to confirm was that's because this fish has absolutely no red blood cells. None at all. This was quite a shock for Rud because
It was thought up to that moment that every vertebrate, every animal with a backbone on the planet Earth had red blood cells. And that means red blood cells have been nourishing vertebrate life for more than 500 million years. And somehow, this fish is living without these cells altogether. Now, to put this in a little bit of context, not only are they the only vertebrates without red blood cells, but if one is to spin this blood in a tube to pack the cells down, it turns out that 99% of its blood is just water. Only about 1% are cells at all, and they're all white cells. By comparison, its closest red-blooded fish cousins have about 15 to 18% of their blood volume as red blood cells, and you and I have about 45% of our packed blood volume as red blood cells. Now, anything less than that we refer to as anemia, and anything substantially less than that is life-threatening. But somehow, this fish has no red blood cells at all. So what's the explanation? What's going on? Well, the first thing you might want to think about is where it lives. And where it lives is a fairly special place. The waters are about 30 degrees Fahrenheit. So below the freezing temperature of fresh water, there's ice flows obviously there, but the salinity of the ocean is sufficient that it doesn't freeze in this area at 30 degrees Fahrenheit. So there is water to swim in. But nonetheless, this is very, very cold water. And if you think about it, not you living in Nashville, but those of us who live in Wisconsin think about this about 11 months out of the year, which is blood is a fairly viscous fluid. And at cold temperatures, it gets a little harder to push around, just like the oil in my car. And what it looks like the Antarctic fish has done is it has junked these red blood cells altogether. It has very dilute blood, sort of ice water in its veins, and it's just pumping this very dilute blood around and oxygenating its tissues that way. It has no active mechanism of delivering oxygen to its tissues as you and I and every other vertebrate on the planet does. So this appears to be an adaptation to very cold environment. Now, why in the world? What is going on that would cause this fish to do this? So to understand that a little bit, we got to think a little bit about this part of the world and its history. And it turns out the pieces of the puzzle start to make some sense. If you looked at a map of the world about 40 million years ago, very early map makers, South America and Antarctica were connected. And it was about 33 to 35 million years ago that connection was eventually severed, and that opened up what we call the Drake Passage, after Sir Francis Drake. And the opening of this passage really changed ocean currents around Antarctica. And this sort of circumpolar current, as it's referred to, made these waters more isolated and colder, such that they dropped on average from about 50 degrees Fahrenheit 40 million years ago to about 30 degrees Fahrenheit today. So a pretty dramatic shift. So for many animals, for many fish, this is just too darn cold, and they either went extinct or they had to migrate to warmer waters. But the ice fish, through its various adaptations, is exploiting this environment, thriving, doing just fine, living in this water that's 30 degrees Fahrenheit. Now, I'd like to tell you more about the evolutionary story of the ice fish, and normally the way a biologist would tell you the story of what they know about the history of a species is we'd go to the fossil record. But there's no fossil record for this species, no fossil record for this group, in fact. There are no deposits of these fish anywhere that we can tap into. But there is a record that we can look into to understand how these fish have adapted to sub-freezing waters. There is a place that we can look for those clues, and that's the DNA record. The DNA record of the ice fish, when we scrutinize that, when we look at the actual genetic code of an ice fish, it reveals a lot. It reveals what was lost and what was modified and what was gained in the course of evolution. It's a whole new window on the evolutionary process and a very recently acquired window for biologists. So what I want to tell you now is just an example of the sort of things we can learn from the DNA record of this ice fish. Makes a lot of sense. And I'm going to give you one example of a loss, a modification, and a gain. So you get some sense of what biologists are doing these days to reconstruct evolutionary history from this forensic record. Let me start with a loss, and it's a very dramatic loss. In our blood, oxygen is carried around by proteins called hemoglobin. These are encoded by genes called globin genes. And if you were to look at a particular part of a chromosome of a red-blooded fish, it would have two globin genes just like this. So this is just a little schematic as though you were going along the chromosome and looking at the DNA, and you'd see a chunk of text of DNA essentially that encodes the globin genes. But if you were to look at that exact same place in a bloodless ice fish, you'd see that one of these genes is missing altogether, and the other one is just a truncated remnant. Makes no sense at all. cannot make a functional hemoglobin whatsoever. So this is essentially just a broken piece of sort of yesterday's globin gene. That's all that's left behind. And this remnant is just sitting there in the DNA, this piece of text, sort of missing at least a paragraph, so it doesn't make sense anymore. And it's eroding away, much as the way a fossil erodes an exposed rock, sort of losing some of itself with time due to, you know, wind and water and the passage of time. So these fossil genes, this fossil globin gene, tells us a couple very important things. The ancestors of this fish had globin genes. We can infer that because there's at least a partial remnant here and because all of its cousins do have globin genes. So this is definitely a loss. And it tells us that there's a signature of this adaptation of the loss of red blood cells in the DNA, right there. It's junked the cells, and it's junked the major working protein in those cells that carries oxygen to its tissues. Now, of course, evolution isn't all about loss. It's about some other things. It's also about modification. Just want to give you, there's lots of modifications to ice fish DNA and to the way the ice fish lives. I'm just going to give you one example and relate it to how different their lifestyle is than ours. So in all our cells, there are these proteins that form tubules, and these tubules form a sort of a scaffold in all our cells. And they're lit up here in this beautiful photomicrograph of this little green network of tubules. And these microtubules form the scaffold, and they're necessary for cell shape and for cell division, lots of normal functioning of cells. And these tubules will collapse, our tubules will collapse, at less than 50 degrees Fahrenheit. Now, that would be a bad thing. But for an ice fish, its microtubules assemble in these long tubules, and they're stable at 30 degrees Fahrenheit, at below the freezing temperature of fresh water. And when we scrutinize, the DNA code for the tubulin genes, we can clearly see that they've evolved changes that have allowed these proteins to be adapted to the cold. So this is an aspect of cell physiology that goes on in every cell in the fish's body that has changed in order to, again, live in that extreme environment. Now again, evolution is about more than just losses and modifications. It's also about some inventions. And the ice fish has a really nifty invention. So these fish, they feed on krill, these little shrimp-like creatures, and these krill feed on algae that grow on the sea ice. So these fish are very often right up in contact with the sea ice. Now, because their tissues, just like yours and mine, have a high water content, there's a danger in touching sea ice. They would freeze like a fish stick. Okay? But they don't freeze like a fish stick because their tissues and their bloodstream are chock full of antifreeze. Again, they beat us to it by millions of years. They figured this out. This antifreeze is a very peculiar family of proteins made in large quantities, circulating through their blood, and it reduces, it inhibits the formation of ice crystals and therefore reduces the freezing temperature of their body fluids and protects them against essentially freezing up solid. And this is a very peculiar family of proteins, as I said, but what's very neat is that biologists at the University of Illinois have been able to trace the history of this antifreeze. And you look at this peculiar piece of DNA code and say, well, geez, where did that come from? Well, it turns out that's traceable in the DNA record as well. And it's clear that this antifreeze came from a little piece of another gene, actually a digestive enzyme, that broke off, went to a new place in a chromosome, and then was tinkered with over the course of evolution to make antifreeze. So it's really a beautiful example of how nature invents using sort of pre-existing materials, in this case genetic code from another gene, to make something new, in this case antifreeze for adapting to the cold. So those three messages about this very peculiar fish encompass the major theme I want to tell you about tonight, which is understanding the making of the fittest. That is, what has actually gone on to make the adaptations possible that allow them animals or other organisms to live where they do. This is inscribed in a fantastic and rich DNA record. And so the DNA record of the ice fish and the DNA record of all species reveals a lot about history and about how evolution works. And the main themes I want to visit tonight are how Earth and life evolved together. Remember, I showed you the history of the geology of this region, and I'm showing you the DNA record of species that live in that region, and it makes a lot of sense. It's telling us that these animals have been adapting to changes on Earth in that region where they live. And the shifts in lifestyle are reflected in the DNA of pertinent genes. So a fish like this has about 20,000 genes. They haven't all changed, just some of these genes have changed in very particular ways in adapting to the cold. And that record vividly documents Darwin's principles of natural selection, which is really what I'm here to tell you about, but I'm going to put it in all sorts of other terms for you. But just to be honest and fair to Mr. Darwin, who just turned 198 in February, I want you to read a little passage with me. It's the longest piece of text I'm going to quote all night, don't worry. From The Origin of Species, and this is his definition of natural selection. And he says, in his halting English, "Can it then be thought improbable that other variations useful in some way to each being in the great and complex battle of life should sometimes occur in the course of thousands of generations? And if such do occur, can we doubt, remembering that many more individuals are born than could possibly survive, that individuals having any advantage, however slight, over others would have the best chance of surviving and procreating their kind?" And this is the really two important parts. This part's often forgotten. "On the other hand, we may feel sure that any variation in the least degree injurious would be rigidly destroyed. And this preservation of favorable variations and the rejection of injurious variations, I call natural selection." Pretty straightforward. I just don't know what all the fuss is about. But think about, Darwin understood that certain variations would be injurious. And the other thing I want you to take home, especially from the ice fish model and a few other things I'm going to tell you tonight, is that the making of the fittest is not an absolute process. What could be good for one species, in this case the loss of red blood cells, could be catastrophic for another. And certain mutations that would be beneficial in one, under one set of circumstances could be detrimental or neutral under others. The making of the fittest is a very conditional process. There's no absolute value to mutations. There's no absolute value to variations. Everything depends upon the conditions the organisms are living in. So certain variations are going to be favorable, the loss of red blood cells for those fish, but in our case, the loss of red blood cells would be the end of us. So this process of natural selection operates on variation, but it can operate in lots of different directions. So what I want to focus on for the rest of my talk are a few more stories about interesting creatures, and I want to focus on this great and complex battle of life and how it leaves a record in DNA and show you some things from that DNA record. I think some highlights and some surprises from this massive DNA record of evolution. And when I say massive, let me put that in a little context for you. 20 years ago, if you took all of the DNA sequence that biologists had deciphered and you were to type that out, so that's just ACGT, GTD, AGG, this simple alphabet of DNA, and you were to type that out and fill pages with it, it would fill about an average size novel. If you were to do that today and you were to stack those novels, it would be more than four times the height of the Sears Tower in Chicago. And most of that growth is in the last 5 years. So there's an immense amount of data now at biologists' fingertips. In fact, so much data that it is, in all honesty, almost overwhelming. But when we put on our miner's hat and go into this data, we find little gems. And I'm hopefully going to show you some of those gems in the course of the rest of my talk. I want to focus on being able to see certain steps in evolution that we can see in precise detail. And I know there's some plainclothes biologists in the audience. I even hope some of these stories that you've not even heard before. So they're not in textbooks yet, you know, but I think they will be. And toward the end of my talk, talk a little bit more about why understanding evolution matters. Now, to illustrate the battle and the record, I'm going to focus entirely on one aspect of sort of nature's great and complex battle. And that's the battle between seeing and not being seen. Now, I could talk about all sorts of things, you know, antifreezes and microtubules and all this sort of stuff, and you'd all be running back for the wine. If you're not thinking that already, but they did. I think they've locked the door. So, I want to focus totally on this battle between sort of seeing and not being seen, the evolutionary game of hide and seek. And to sort of warm you up, to show you what I mean first, I'm going to talk about the evolution on the human battlefield before I get to the animal battlefield, so you get some sense of what I'm talking about. So, let's go to the human battlefield and the battle of seeing and not being seen. And this is a painting of the Anglo-Zulu War. Those of you who have ever seen the movie, it was Michael Caine's featured debut. I think it's one of the worst movies ever made. But for some reason, all the British people I know think it's one of the best movies ever made. I can't explain that. Okay, so here's a painting not an excerpt of the movie. And you'll notice these brilliant red uniforms that the British were wearing late in the 19th century. And these splendid color uniforms were used to build pride and help distinguish friend and foe in close combat. So they had a useful purpose in that at close combat, it was very, you know, good to know not to bayonet your buddy, but to bayonet the enemy. And so these are the red coat uniforms. But what happened was, as weaponry evolved, as rifles gained longer range and cannons gained longer range and greater accuracy, that of course these uniforms were a real handicap. And what the British invented was the khaki uniform. These uniforms evolved for concealment. For example, these are the khaki uniforms out on the South African veld, and these are the uniforms that were worn in the Second Boer War right around the turn of the last century. Just a little side note here, I would have dumped the white belts, but you know. Old traditions die hard. Okay, so the British adapted to the landscape also of not only South Africa, but of India with the khaki uniform. It was very important for concealment. Now, interestingly, not all armies around the world caught on. This is an actual photograph, one of these treasures you find when you surf late at night. This is an actual photograph of French army soldiers in World War I camped in the field, and you'll see that they're wearing these dark blue jackets and their bright red called Garance trousers, and they were very fond of this color scheme. Let me tell you what a British reporter had to say when he visited the front lines about the French. This is an actual quote from the Manchester Guardian, 18th of August, 1914. "The French are under a severe handicap in the matter of uniform. It is over a dozen years since the Boer War, and certainly they should have discarded the blue coat and red trousers for a more neutral color. The flamboyant uniform of the line regiments makes a fair mark as far as the modern rifle is effective. In groups, they are all the gunner asks for a target. I wish I could do the accent. These soldiers are as conspicuous as claret stains on a new tablecloth." So, not wanting to be claret stains, they adapted, and they came up with these horizon blue uniforms to blend against the sky and these khaki uniforms for the trenches. And this is the adaptation they made within about a year of the outbreak of the war. So that's just to give you a sense that there's an arms race going on, of course, in human history, and uniforms and weapons have been evolving. The same game has been played in nature. So now let's move to an animal battlefield. This, if you've never been to this part of the country, this is a rather remarkable part of southern Arizona called the Pinacate Desert. And this is a lava flow. So Arizona, if you visited there, you may have seen various parts of Arizona are covered with pretty dramatic geological features, including lava flows. And about three major episodes in the past million years where there have been major eruptions and flows across the landscape. So you see these beautiful saguaro cacti with this really black lava rock and these big lava outcrops. This is just another view of one of these lava flows across an otherwise sort of sandy desert or a rocky desert landscape. So the earth has been changing in this part of the world. It looked like more than a million years ago something more like this, and now has been covered in various places with lava rock. And this battlefield is the home of a humble, but I think eventually will be famous. I don't know if it's going to reach the Galapagos finch level, but in my view, it should. A famous animal, the soon-to-be famous animal, the humble rock pocket mouse. Yes, this is what you get. Thank goodness the NCAAs aren't going on tonight, because I'd have no crowd. But this is what you gave up your Thursday night for, the rock pocket mouse. Now, the rock pocket mouse comes in two flavors. It comes in a sandy color and in chocolate. Okay. And if we look at these mice on the different backgrounds, you can see that sandy blends with sandy very nicely, and chocolate blends with black lava rock. But they don't blend so well on the contrasting habitats. And it turns out that color matching for these mice is very important. Naturalists have studied these mice for about 70 years, and they know a lot about how they live and about their predators. And one of their major predators are owls. And the reason why that's important is, imagine these two mice sitting together on this rock. Well, if you're a dark mouse, you're a claret stain on a new tablecloth. But on the opposite background, whereas this mouse would be just fine, your dinner. So the genes that govern whether the mouse is sandy or chocolate color, they don't have any absolute value. It's not that one is good and one is bad. It all depends on where the mice live. It all depends on the conditions of selection the mouse exists in. And so in adapting to the changing earth, what was ancestrally a sandy mouse species has evolved this black variant that has invaded the lava rocks and can live among these rocks and take advantage of the habitat and food opportunities on these lava rocks that the sandy mice can't do so well. And the difference between sandy and chocolate, we know very precisely. The gene, there's a single gene difference between these two forms of this mouse. And Michael Nachman at the University of Arizona and his group has figured out that the sandy-colored mice have two copies of this particular gene called MC1R. It's not that important, the name of the gene, but some of the biologists might want to know. And that determines color variation, because if you have one of the a copy of the black form that just has a couple of mutations in it, or if you have two copies of the black form, then you are dark. So the mutations that happen in this gene, which under original circumstances of just a sandy-colored desert, would be detrimental, would be injurious, because those dark mice would stand out on that background. With the new habitat, they were advantageous. So again, the fittest here has to do with conditions. It's not the absolute value of a mutation. So Earth and life evolved together. These mice show that. The Earth was changing. This is how the mice invaded new habitat. So I'm going to show you another example of a game of evolutionary hide and seek, and this time the predator gets the upper hand. And we're going to change the battlefield from southern Arizona to northern Europe. Yes, you're going to think I have some kind of rodent fixation, but I think you can appreciate that biologists have to work on animals where they can do the studies more readily. This is hard work to do with elephants. Work with small animals. So this is a vole, okay? Now this is not shown, this is like a Monty Python-sized vole, okay? So this is just to show you that the vole lives in these green fields and would be otherwise inconspicuous if we didn't magnify him like 100-fold, okay? So the vole lives in these green fields, and we know a lot about these voles, and we know about their predators. And one of their predators is the European kestrel, a raptor. Now the kestrel's got an interesting challenge. So the kestrel is going to fly over the verdant fields of northern Europe looking for his favorite food, these voles. How is this kestrel going to find its food? Well, I'll tell you, it's going to use its vision, but it's fairly tricky to pick out a vole from some altitude hidden in that grass. So the kestrel's got a trick. And to appreciate that trick, I got to tell you a little bit more about how animals see, even including ourselves. So what's going on with vision? Well, the way we see and the way we see color, what we refer to as the visible spectrum of light, has to do with the different wavelengths of light of the sun and the way they excite various receptors in our eyes. And these receptors, the protein receptors in our eyes, are called opsins. And virtually all of us in the room have three of these opsins. And these three opsins are tuned to different wavelengths. And each of these opsins is encoded by a different gene. And we have what's called full color vision across this color spectrum because we have these three opsins, and these opsins can detect light of essentially virtually all the wavelengths across here and to integrate that in what we see as color. I'm not going to talk about another opsin, but there is one for seeing in dim light. Now, we humans, great apes and old world monkeys, have these three opsins. You may be curious to know that your dog and your cat or your guinea pig or your gerbil or whatever it may be at home, other mammals, do not have these three opsins. The third opsin came along early in primate evolution in the old world, such that old world monkeys and great apes have this third opsin, but other mammals don't. So that's a capacity that we have that other mammals don't. But it turns out that birds and reptiles and fish generally do have this full color vision, some of them even better than ourselves. And just in case you're curious about what the significance of color vision might be for us, I'm going to take a little further aside and show you why it probably was really important to our ancestors and our primate relatives. And to do that, I'm going to show you a really short movie clip. Again, had to search all over the world for this movie clip. It lasts about 8 seconds. I'm going to have to show it twice so you see what I'm seeing. This is a movie clip of a red colobus monkey on the island of Zanzibar having breakfast. Okay? And what I want you to pay attention to is what it decides to eat and what it decides to pass up. So here's the monkey. He's up in the canopy. See all these green leaves around? Looks lush, right? That's not what he wants. Could you see? Maybe those down front. Could you see what he reached for? Anybody see the color leaves that he ate? Now watch carefully. He's going to reach out. I don't have slow-mo. They're red and yellow. You can see some of these others here. They're red and yellow. And it turns out if he didn't have full color vision, he couldn't distinguish red leaves from green leaves. Just as you may be aware, about 8% of Caucasian males are colorblind. And that's due to a mutation in these genes. This monkey has full color vision, and that allows him to see red and yellow, distinguish it from green. Why is that important? Turns out those are the younger leaves. Those are the more nutritious, easier to digest leaves. It's also true that's another good signal in fruit. And there's been plenty of studies now on old world primates to understand that they show this preference for red fruits, red leaves, in their foraging habits in the canopy. And you can imagine that's an advantage they have over other animals. So that's some little history of why is it that all old world primates have full color vision, because it probably was a very important competitive advantage. Now, why have I told you about all that? Remember, sometime a while ago, I was talking about a kestrel? Okay, and I didn't have any wine, so, okay. So let's go back to the kestrel. Well, it turns out the kestrel has a mutation in one of its opsin genes. So this violet opsin gene that we have and other birds have, in the kestrel there's a mutation in this opsin gene, and this mutation shifts the sensitivity of this opsin out of the sort of violet part of the visible spectrum and into the ultraviolet. Now for us, and for our primate relatives, this would be a bad mutation. This would definitely distort our sense of color vision. This would change the way we see the world. But what would be bad for us, actually, is a good trick for the kestrel. And the reason why it's a good trick for the kestrel is that vole urine reflects in the ultraviolet. Isn't biology a marvelous thing? Now, some people, I'm gonna just take care of this question right here. People ask me this very often. I don't know how they get the voles to pee in the cups. So that's a secret the researchers have not divulged to me yet. But anyway, so this is vole urine under a little ultraviolet illumination. It reflects. So what's the kestrel's trick? Well, the kestrel's trick is it's scanning for vole trails, because anywhere where there are burrows for the voles or commonly used trails, the voles use that as scent, as a urine as a marker, and for example, in terms of communication among voles. So anywhere there's a high density of voles, there's a high density of urine, and that stands out like a claret stain on a new tablecloth. Not the finest claret, but nonetheless, a claret stain. Okay, so from these couple examples, I want you to take home some generality from my little silly rodents. These are cases of evolving genes. In the one case, it's a coat color gene. In the other case, it's a color vision gene. The variations in coat color arise through completely random mutations. Same with the color vision. It's a completely random mutation, but it's the selective conditions. This is what Darwin was talking about, the habitat, the predators, the mates, etc., that determine which variants are favored, which are the fittest. And there's no absolute value here. Remember, what's good for the kestrel would be bad for us. What's good for the dark mouse would be bad for the sandy mouse. And so what we understand, and there's now tons of examples like this, is that this interplay of random mutation and of natural selection, meaning the favoring of particular variants, the reproductive and survival advantage of variants bearing certain mutations, is sufficient to explain the diversity of life. Only now we can pinpoint the exact changes in the DNA that make animals look different, behave different, have different capabilities, etc. So we're into the deep record of evolution. Now, you might be thinking, if things are so conditional, there might be a flip side to this. Capabilities need to evolve, so that means that sometimes capabilities might be changing. And that's true. And what happens when capabilities are no longer needed? And that leaves a DNA record. And I want to tell you about that because I don't think it's something that's too intuitive, but it turns out to be a really dramatic part of the DNA record. And to tell you this story, I'm going to stay with color vision. I'm going to switch animals a little bit and go to fish. I'm going to stay with color vision to illustrate another principle we can see from the DNA record. So reef fish, these brightly colored reef fish, are using color vision and their body colors as a form of communication. And in shallow water, all the wavelengths of sunlight reach that shallow water, and of course, so they're in a very colorful environment. Now, at greater depths, okay, those wavelengths don't reach. They're filtered out, they're scattered, et cetera, and as you know, in the deep blue sea, things are sort of monochrome. So I'll show you, for example, the habitat of another fish. And if there's any undergrads in here, you get to answer the question first, see if you can identify who this fish is before you let the pros in on it. So this is a little film footage of a deep water fish. Hint, it's famous. I see him mumbling. It's got to be an undergrad. I'll move up to graduate student. Coelacanth, there you go, okay. So that's a coelacanth. Not everybody's seen a coelacanth, but this is, there you go. Well done. So the coelacanth here lives in deep water. It lives essentially in caves during the day and goes out at night to feed, so it doesn't see much sunlight at all. And if we look at that very same opsin gene in a clownfish or any other sort of reef fish and compare it with a coelacanth, there's a really dramatic difference. And I'm just going to show you this schematically. So here's a fish living in shallow water and a fish living in deep water, a coelacanth. If you look at this opsin gene, the gene is perfectly intact and it's functioning in color vision for this fish. But if you look at the very same gene of the coelacanth, it has four defects in it. Each one is sufficient to render the gene inactive. So it has four defects that have accumulated. This gene is non-functional. It's a fossil sitting in the DNA, just as that little piece of globin gene is in the ice fish. Now, how could that be? It's because mutations in this gene are not affecting the performance of this fish whatsoever. It lives in deep water. It's not using full color vision. And so mutations occur in this gene because there's no natural selection is essentially blind to this. It does not cause a performance disadvantage in these fish whatsoever. And it turns out when we look at the genomes of virtually any species, we find these fossil genes. And these fossil genes are good clues to how the lifestyles of these organisms have shifted from those of their ancestors. So the simplest explanation here is sometime in the ancestry of the coelacanth, there was a shift to deeper water. And that relaxed natural selection on the violet opsin gene, so it's no longer being used. And when you say what I mean by this gene has about 1,200 letters of code to it. There are about four defects in there that make the code unreadable by the genetic machinery. But we can tell from the other 1,196 letters of code that that was one day an opsin gene. Okay, so what can we learn about these fossil genes? Now, I've told you about fossil genes in an ice fish. I told you about fossil genes in a coelacanth. Is this just something you see in really peculiar and weird animals that live in strange parts of the world? Not at all. And to walk you through that and have you make the connection about the relationship between fossil genes and the lifestyles of animals, I want to show you a few more examples. So let's move to this guy. I heard that. That's the little awe factor. Okay. So here's a nocturnal owl monkey. If we look at, with his big eyes, this is a strictly nocturnal animal. If we look at its violet opsin gene, that same gene we've been looking at in the coelacanth, the same gene we were looking at in the kestrel, it too is a fossil in this monkey. Now, it turns out the mutations are different. So they've happened independently. They've happened in the history of this species at a separate time and in a different part of the world from what's happened to the coelacanth and what's happened to the kestrel. But nonetheless, this gene is fossilized. Now, what's the connection here? It lives in the dark. Okay. Here's another case. This is the nocturnal bush baby. Different lineage from the owl monkey. You look at that very same violet opsin gene, same story. Different set of mutations than what you see in the owl monkey or in the coelacanth, but nonetheless, this gene's fossilized. This, too, is a nocturnal animal. Okay, so if you like those, this is now going to test just how cuddly you find all mammals. Here's the third example. So this is the subterranean blind mole rat. This is a mammal with the most degenerate eyes of any mammal on the planet. And it lives, I'll clue you in, mostly underground. A pretty dark habitat. That dark habitat essentially relaxes selection on color vision. The genes involved in color vision go to pot because over time, mutations hit them, and those mutations, rather being swept away by the natural selection process, accumulate because there's no performance disadvantage for these mammals. So now I've shown you a few more examples of fossil genes, and granted, the subterranean blind mole rat might sound kind of extreme. So is this just something that we see in, you know, nocturnal animals or animals living underground or cave animals or whatever else? No. Let me show you perhaps the weirdest animal of all, us. This is the data from our genome. We have roughly, let's call it a little over 20,000 genes. There are 887 fossil genes cataloged so far in our DNA. That's right, we're carrying around in the form of genes that were once active somewhere in our ancestry and no longer functioning now, 887 of these. 67 of these have been fossilized just since the split with a common ancestor with chimpanzees. So this is a process that goes on somewhat continuously, that as lifestyles change, as functions are no longer needed, as performance from these various genes are no longer needed, mutations can accumulate in these genes. And what's nice is that for biologists, we can capture these genes in the state of decay and their clues to the lifestyles of ancestors, and they tell us a lot about how current species are different from their ancestors. So we've got a lot of these fossil genes, and in the Q&A, I'd be happy. Here's a planted question. I'd be happy to tell you about some of those examples, some of which make a heck of a lot of sense with respect to what else I've told you about some of our unique genetic capabilities. So this is just a taste of the DNA record, of evolving genes and of fossil genes, of this massive DNA record that allows us to piece together the steps in evolution of how various capabilities have evolved. And this is being done now on a massive scale for all sorts of species. The fossil genes in particular tell us something about lifestyles of ancestors. And what's also very satisfying, if you think about it a while, about fossil genes, this is exactly what we should expect to find in the absence of natural selection. A good rule of thumb, essentially, for any piece of DNA is use it or lose it. It's going to decay over time if there's no pressure to maintain its function. I think the fossil genes in particular thwart the intuition that evolution is somehow a progressive process. You know, we're not really different from other species. I mean, we're not really, better equipped than other species genetically. We're just mostly different. Let me give that to you in terms of numbers of genes. We have essentially the same number of genes as a chimp, the same number of genes as a mouse. We have the same number of genes as a pufferfish, okay? Yeah, that may not be such welcome news, but we're just gonna have to get over it, okay? So we're mostly just different, not better equipped. Many, many years ago, some biologists thought we were gonna find thousands and thousands of human-specific genes that were gonna explain, you know, our top of the pinnacle. Well, just as the fleas on the back of that dog tell you, we are not the top of the pinnacle. And I think it also is another piece to address this notion of somehow biology being designed. I, for one, wouldn't understand why a designer would design non-functional genes. It turns out this is exactly what you expect to find under Darwinian evolution, and not what you'd expect to find if our DNA code was designed as an engineer would do it. So there's a rich, rich DNA record. And we're tapping it to ask a lot of questions now, questions that we couldn't even formulate 5 or 6 years ago. It's just a recent cover of a Time magazine framing the question that now biologists are asking about what makes us human, what makes us different from chimps, even what makes us different from Neanderthals. You may have heard the story that it's now possible with new methods to sequence ancient DNA like that of Neanderthals and start to map the genetic differences that have evolved between ourselves and our most recent extinct relative. So I would argue in many ways it's a new golden age of evolutionary biology. You know, only we're not naturalists on boats going to South America, we're naturalists with browsers going to Google. There couldn't be a better time to be an evolutionary biologist, at least in the laboratory, although it's perhaps, you know, a golden age for biology is still perhaps a dark age elsewhere. Just let that sink in. Now, I've been carrying that slide for about a year and a half, and I just won't hide it. It gives me great pleasure to update that slide. Now, I've picked a lot on Tom DeLay, but I have to mention, I came across an interesting quote just a few days ago in my Googling. Anyone know this quote? We've hunted for almost 150 years and not found supporting evidence. Okay. In case you don't know who he is, I found a picture of him also on Google. There he is. If he can't see the evidence for evolution, I think he's just driving off the cliff there with Mr. Magoo. Anyway, so of course we understand, as Chancellor Gee said, that this discussion, this debate, the supposed controversy continues. Obviously, there's no controversy in scientific circles whatsoever, yet the teaching of evolution is constantly under attack and challenge, and this is what Senator Finney had in mind. If you don't know more about it, you can pick up these stories, essentially asking one of the departmental administrators, I think, in secondary education in Tennessee to comment on various ideas about the origin of the universe and things like that, and claiming that there's no evidence out there for the theory of evolution. So, there's a lot to be said on this angle, and I'm not going to derail the rest of your evening with it. But the question you might ask, is this just a philosophical issue, or is there something more to it? Why does it matter? Why does really understanding evolution matter? And there's actually a lot of different answers to that question that all sorts of people, teachers and laymen and scientists would come up with. But I'm just going to focus on one. And I want to illustrate to you, I think, why a practical understanding of evolution is just good for us to have, even in our own self-interest. So to do that, I want to underscore this major theme I've been telling you about how the fittest is a conditional status, if not a precarious one. So natural selection, if you think about what I've shown you, it acts only in the present. It can't preserve what is not needed, and it can't plan for the future. So there was no way for the coelacanth to kind of hold that code for the violet opsin gene pristine, just in case a million years from now, coelacanth might like to live in a sunnier place, okay? And the ice fish has lost its globin genes forever. There's no going back. Well, the practical implication of that is if conditions, remember, Earth and life are changing together, so if conditions on Earth change faster than adaptations can arise, faster than the fittest can be made by this process of mutation and selection, then species are doomed. So to illustrate this problem, let's return to Bouvet Island in the current day. Beautiful photograph of snow-covered Bouvet. And let's go under the sea at Bouvet. It's a remarkable place, and I've been given some footage by an Antarctic researcher named Bill Dietrich at Northeastern University. So this give you a little glimpse of what it looks like under the sea, under the Antarctic Sea. But it is also a place that's changing, and I'll say a little bit more about that after this film. So this is actual footage in real time from a remote-operated vehicle. That's cold water, so divers, it's pretty dangerous to dive, and this is pretty far down, of what the sea bottom looks like around Bouvet. And the first thing you'll notice at these depths are the starfish trucking across the bottom in real time. So it's a very rich ecosystem. We're not talking barren here at all. These are oxygen-rich waters, plankton-rich waters, and there it is, an ice fish guarding a nest of eggs. So that's a real ice fish, and that's a male guarding the eggs. So they were liberated millions of years ahead of humankind. Look at what we can learn from these humble and strange fish. Okay, so that's the ice fish habitat. Let me just tell you a little bit more about the ice fish and things in its habitat. So let me tell you about its food. Krill, biologists think, is the most abundant animal on the planet, these shrimp-like creatures. Ditlef Rusted actually devoted an entire monograph to krill, something that thick, so he was very fond of them. These animals, as I told you before, they feed on algae. They're found under the surface of the sea ice. Well, it turns out long-term studies over maybe 5 to 6 decades have shown that krill populations have declined by about 80% in waters near the Antarctic Peninsula since about 1970. And the chain of interaction seems to be, for example, that as the Antarctic Peninsula warms, and it's warmed, the air temperature is warmed by about 2.5 degrees Celsius in the last 50 years, there's a decrease in sea ice. And if there's less sea ice, then there's less sea ice for the algae to live on. And if there's fewer algae, then there's less food for the krill. And if there's fewer krill, then there's less food for seals, albatross, whales, and ice fish. So there's a domino effect of the change in the climate in this part of the world on, of course, the food web in this part of the world. And it would impact the ice fish for sure. Now, these ice fish, I have to tell you, the fittest here is so conditional because they depend on those ice-cold water, oxygen-rich waters for survival. When one takes these ice fish out of the water and warms them up for a few degrees, you know, and still in a seawater tank, they become very, very, very sluggish. And just a few degrees above their normal temperature, they essentially are going to expire. So they are adapted to a pretty narrow range of temperature here out at the extreme of ocean temperature. So you can imagine that they're being stressed by these circumstances. Now for the really depressing part of my talk. That would be bad enough, except for the ice fish also were the target of a commercial fishing effort. So after various other stocks were heavily fished in the Southern Ocean, various countries turned to fishing ice fish, and the first commercial effort was in 1971. Took 235,000 tons of these fish at the peak in 1978, and you can see how the catches dwindled off pretty rapidly. So that combination of fishing pressure, which is depleted populations, and the changing ecosystem, et cetera, makes the ice fish and that beautiful ecosystem under Bouvet Island, of course, very vulnerable to relatively small changes in ocean temperature and in sea ice, et cetera. So this is what we have to understand. There's no going back for these ice fish. And there's lots of other species that are cold adapted to those waters or to life in the Antarctic that are living in a very narrow band of adaptation. So what's the take-home message? Well, it's not even my own message. I'm going to reach back to something that was written 50 years ago by Julian Huxley. Julian Huxley is the grandson of Thomas Huxley. You may know Thomas Huxley as Darwin's bulldog, one of the great champions of Darwin's theory. Julian Huxley is also the brother of Aldous Huxley, the novelist who wrote Brave New World. I'd say a pretty decent gene pool in that family because a third brother won the Nobel Prize for Physiology. So anyway, but we don't know those genes yet, I guess. When we all find out the Huxley intelligence genes, I think that will make the news. But here's what Julian Huxley had to say 50 years ago, long before you'd say the environmental movement was prevalent. It is as if man had been appointed managing director of the biggest business of all, the business of evolution. And whether he's conscious of what he's doing or not, he is in point of fact determining the future direction of evolution of this earth. That is his inescapable destiny, and the sooner he realizes it and starts believing it, the better for all concerned. And of course, we're hearing a lot more about this these days. Now, so we are in charge of the biggest business of all, and parts of the earth are changing rapidly, and we know enough biology to know that that's reason for concern. Now, of course, it's an enormous challenge to start believing in this and taking charge, especially in these difficult and polarized times. But I'm going to be an optimist. I don't think there's any other choice. To succeed in preserving nature, we can't let pessimism prevail. We have to persuade each other and the powerful that nature is worth preserving. And for that long campaign, we're going to need every ounce of optimism that we can muster. So in closing, I'm going to offer you a few words of encouragement from another eminent British voice. If I can switch over to the DVD. Oops, did we start already? We'll take that out a second. It got going on its own. I'm sorry about that. A little choreography. You get the lights down? Okay. So yeah, so this is just, I want you to take those sad thoughts of the ice fish out of the auditorium tonight. I want you to go out thinking about the bright side and all the parts of nature that are worth saving. Oh, it's going to do this to me. Sorry about that. Yeah, I'll get it down. It's just a DVD player. All Okay. Now it should be happy. This is not. Drama, this. And here comes the second stop. There we go. And let it reload.
Some things in life are bad. Other things just make you swear and curse. When you're chewing on life's gristle, that grumble, give a whistle. And this'll help things turn out for the best. Aim. Always look on the bright side of life. Always look on the light side of life. If life seems jolly rotten, there's something you've forgotten. And that's to laugh and smile and dance and sing. When you're feeling in the dumps, don't be silly chums. Purse your lips and whistle, that's the thing. Aim. Always look on the bright side of life. Come on. Always look on the bright side of life. For life is quite absurd, and death's the final word. You must face the curtain with a bang. Forget about your scene. Give the audience a grin. Enjoy it. It's your last chance anyhow. So always look on the bright side of death. Just before you draw your terminal breath. Life's a piece of shit. When you look at it, life's a laugh and death's a joke, it's true. You'll see it's all a show, keep them laughing as you go. Just remember that the last laugh is on you. And always look on the bright side of life. Always look on the right side of life.
Thanks a lot. The things you can do with a Macintosh and stock footage. So that movie was made by my colleague Steve Paddock, who's been involved in various movie-making adventures before, so appreciate that. That, of course, was Monty Python's music, and you won't tell them I used it, will you? Anyway, we have a few minutes for questions. I'm sorry I've run a little bit long. I'm happy to take anything that might occur to you while we have a little bit of time. Everything is abundantly clear. Sir?
Yeah, I was just wondering, as an evolutionary biologist, could you feel like some of the people's views are to go against evolution? Like when there's like so much evidence and pointed out, why do people still try to be like, you know, I believe in creationism or something like that?
Well, Here's the thing. The question is, you know, why are people still holding out against evolutionary evidence? And for example, and the gentleman mentioned the creationist point of view. Here's the point that I'd like to make. I think the denial of the evidence for evolution is either stubbornness or ignorance. Okay, there's just no other way around it. However, that does not deny a lot of religious thought that's really important to people in this country. So I think the ground that is not being seized is the ground to understand that religion is something different than science, and that plenty of people, plenty of denominations, have made that accommodation a long time ago. But a very vocal crowd insists that their view of the world, their religious view of the world, must be correct, and therefore the science must be incorrect, and the scientists, for example, must have some other agenda. And that's the battle that you're seeing. That's the battle you're seeing in the courts. That's a battle that you're seeing the media sort of foster. And I think the tragedy of the last couple of years is that the very polarized views, I think, from the fundamentalist community and the hapless scientist hasn't gotten us anywhere. You know, this sort of CNN theater of sort of, you know, 6 minutes of two people talking at each other doesn't get you anywhere and doesn't represent the fact that for a vast number of Americans, but the scientific evidence for evolution is overwhelming and it doesn't challenge their faith. And what we're not seeing in the media often enough, or I haven't really seen them at all, are people, for example, leading clergy or theologians, and there are plenty of them, and I'll give you names, who fully accept evolutionary science and then have something to say on the theological side. But instead, we've gone for this sort of combat theater in the media, which I think has just made it a lot harder for this discussion to take place in kind of an interesting way. I do think, of course, it makes the holdouts look silly, but that's just my opinion. Sir.
What are the two or three broad perspective pointers or forecasts you can draw from your work?
About the direction of evolution?
Yes.
I won't say anything about human evolution. There's 6 billion of us, and most biologists appreciate that evolution works really, really well on islands. And now that we've been intermingling for a long time and a lot of our populations have mixed, you might have had, you know, if humans had gone on isolated in various parts of the world for hundreds of thousands of years, we'd have a lot of different human species. But I don't really have any forecasts as to where 6 billion humans are heading. We're still under natural selection, and every pathogen should be reminding us of that, whether it's malaria or HIV or any sort of bacterium, et cetera. So we've not escaped the grips of natural selection. We just have evolved various technologies to try to give us an upper hand. Yeah.
With this new knowledge that we have from studying the genome and genetics, then what impact will that have on natural selection? Will it alter it?
Well, we've been altering sort of natural selection, and just the dramatic change in our longevity is a, you know, just hygiene. Clean plumbing was probably the biggest invention, you know, evolutionary invention of the last two centuries, right? Clean drinking water and better hygiene has done wonders for our longevity. You know, I think we're understanding that we're as every generation appears to have a longer expected lifespan. I mean, we're obviously going to approach, we're approaching some kind of limit, but nonetheless, you know, there's more of us around because we have devised technologies that make us not as vulnerable to natural selection. You know, I have, you know, if I take these off, where are you? You know, I would be lion fodder on the savannah of Africa, but, you know, I can make it in academia, which is, you know, kind of a marginal existence anyway. So we have been relaxing selection on humans for sure, but we're a very, very large population, and you know, pockets of us are of course, you know, still very vulnerable to environmental thing, you know, pathogens and things like this. But I you know, people ask me, you know, are our brains getting bigger? I see no evidence. You know, might we have 8 toes someday? I don't see that quite happening either. You know, a lot of our changes that we see, if you look at how different humans are from 200 years ago, a lot of that is the combination of nutrition and hygiene, and not really any kind of, you know, there's no genetic mechanism to explain there. It's been too short for natural selection to really work on humans in 200 years. It's just that we've got a lot of calories now when we're growing, and we live in cleaner environments, and so we're living longer, and we're, you know, each generation is a little bit taller than the one before. Sir?
Are we able to insert genes at this point?
In other organisms or in humans? Well, we could do it in humans in cells that we take out of the body. We're still, I think all biologists are pretty reluctant to do anything in human germ cells. But yeah, we're inserting all sorts of genes into crops. We've been doing that for quite a while. That's if you own Monsanto stock, you owe all appreciation to genetic engineering. So we're certainly doing a lot of directed genetic modification. And that too has consequences. When you plant crops that are, you know, massive areas of cropland with genetically uniform crops, there's some vulnerabilities there, for example, when pathogens, whether those are fungi or bacteria or insects or whatever, figure those things out. So we're going to always be in an arms race with those things that want to, you know, live on our skin, live in our water, eat our food, etc. But we do have quite a lot of weaponry now to throw at that. So let me move back. I see a hand up there. Someone younger? Yeah, there you go. No offense there. I want to distribute the. You understand? Thank you.
Are there components within the genetic code that actually mitigate the amount of variation or mutation that can occur? Does that make it a parameter or a degree?
Part of the structure of the genetic code, we refer to it as degenerate, in that the same three letters can have essentially the same meaning. Different sets of three letters can have the same meaning. And the thinking is that that's insulation against mutation. So the genetic code has actually evolved. That little table, if you remember, you know, seeing that table at some point in history, that code we think has evolved partly as a bit of a buffer against the process of mutation. So the structure of the genetic code itself is a product of natural selection and a buffer to the effects of mutation. So about a quarter of all mutations that would happen within the coding regions of genes are silent because they don't change the meaning of the message that gene encodes. Thank you. I ran a little bit.